Welcome to Gospel Truth with Andrew Wommack, a teaching ministry that focuses on God's unconditional love and grace. And now, here's Andrew.
Welcome to our Thursday's broadcast of the Gospel Truth. Today, I'm continuing a series. Actually, I'm ending a series that I've been doing for months talking about God's will. And the third third teaching in this series on God's will has been about how to fulfill God's will. And we're now down to the last teaching in this five-part album, and this is entitled Hope and Imagination. And I tell you, this is really powerful. This is something that I haven't talked about a lot. It's something that I've operated in a lot, but it's relatively new that I've gotten some of this understanding. And I'm talking about the power of imagination, and I tell you, this is indispensable when it comes to fulfilling God's will. I spent all of yesterday's program basically introducing this and just describing that an imagination is something that every one of us have, and it's indispensable. You use it all of the time. Some people think that imagination is just for kids and that as you grow up, you got to get out of fantasy and into reality. Let me contrast the definitions of imagination and fantasy. They aren't the same thing, and some people think that they are, and so therefore they think that an imagination is just living in a fantasy world. It has nothing to do with reality. Here's the dictionary definition of imagination. It means the process or power of forming a mental image of something not real or present, creativity or inventiveness, and resourcefulness. Now that's what an imagination is. Here's the definition of fantasy. It says, a product of the imagination, illusion, or a delusion, a capricious or whimsical notion or idea, a daydream, a fantasia. Now, can you see the difference between that? The fantasy is nearly used exclusively to describe a delusion, something held in spite of invalidating evidence, whereas the imagination is just your ability to see something with your heart or with your mind's eye that you can't see with your physical eyes. I've used the illustration of I'm building a tree house for my granddaughter, and you know what? Before I could start physically building it and seeing with my eyes, I had to picture it on the inside. This is why we use blueprints. This is why instructions come with pictures and diagrams that help you to get it, because you think in pictures. You know, not everybody has thought through this, and some of you may disagree with this, but you do think in pictures. I'm not going to go back through all of yesterday's teaching, but it's important that you get hold of this and understand that you do have an imagination. God made you this way, and it's how you work. Let me use one other illustration, and then I'll go on with this. But when I say apple, you don't see the letters A-P-P-L-E. What you see is a picture of an apple. And there are different types of apples. There's lots of different varieties. There's red apples. There's green apples. Some of you see have a different picture, but with my words, I could begin to start narrowing the description and get everybody to where they're seeing the same thing. I could say a big, red, delicious apple. I could describe an apple and say this one is getting too ripe and it's beginning to shrivel up and it's got a worm coming out of it. And you know, with my words, what I'm doing is changing your picture, but you see it in pictures. You don't see A-P-P-L-E, you have a picture. If I say dog, you don't see D-O-G, but you picture a dog. And most of us will picture a dog that goes along with our experience. Like if you were a kid and had a dog, or if you have a current dog, or if your neighbor has a dog, you would think and picture something that is relative to your experience. And some of you have a big dog, some of you have a little dog, some of you have a white dog, some of you have a black dog. With my words, I could change that picture. I could say, everybody think of a big, black, mean, angry dog. And you know what I'm doing? With those words, everybody's picture is changing. That is your imagination. And your imagination is how you think. You think in pictures. You know, if I was to say something like yesterday, I used the example of a water blivet, so I've already explained that, but if I was to do something different, if I was to pick out some animal or something that nobody had ever seen, and if I just said this word, but if you didn't have a picture of it, then you wouldn't be able to understand what I was talking about. See, when I say elephant, when I say giraffe, when I say bear, when I say dog, all of you can picture that because you've seen one. But if I was to pick out some name of something that you've never seen, you know what? You wouldn't be able to grab hold of it. You wouldn't be able to retain it. You couldn't remember it if you can't picture it. But once you see it, then you attach that word to that picture, and that's how you remember, and that's how you communicate. So your imagination is your ability to see something on the inside, and we use that constantly. Look at this passage of Scripture. This is in the 11th chapter of the book of Genesis, and this is at the Tower of Babel. And after the flood, the people were scattered over all of the earth. They began to spread out. And anyway, a kingdom began to rise up. A person wanted to build a kingdom and to keep everybody together and collectively pool all of their resources. And so what they started doing was building this tower that was going to reach all the way up to heaven. Now see, some people may have thought that was just a fantasy, something that wasn't based in reality. It was a delusion. It was make-believe. But no, I believe that they were serious and that they had... You know, I believe in evolution, but not evolution the way it's taught. I don't believe that we came from a single cell and evolved into this infinitely complex person. I don't believe that our ancestors were cave people that were nothing and they were ignorant and that we've now become modern and sophisticated. I believe in evolution the other direction, that God created Adam and Eve with an intelligence that would just overwhelm people today, and that we have evolved downward. That sin has dulled us and we have lost a lot of our perception. And I believe that back in these days when the Tower of Babel was built, these people were engineering a structure that would reach all the way to heaven. And that wasn't a fantasy, it was an imagination. They were going to build a skyscraper that would amaze people today. And so it says here in Genesis chapter 11, and they said one to another, go to, let us make brick and burn them thoroughly. And they had brick for stone and slime had they for mortar. And they said, go to, let us build us a city and a tower whose top may reach unto heaven. And let us make us a name, lest we be scattered abroad upon the face of the whole earth. And the Lord came down to see the city and the tower which the children of men builded. And the Lord said, behold, the people is one. And they have all one language. And this they begin to do, and now nothing will be restrained from them which they have imagined to do. Go to, let us go down, and there confound their language that they may not understand one another's speech. So the Lord scattered them abroad from thence upon the face of all of the earth, and they left off to build the city. Now, there's a lot of things that we could teach from that, but here's what I was wanting to show you, is that the Lord saw that because the people were one, because they were united, He said nothing that they have imagined will be restrained from them, that they have imagined to do. The Lord right here linked their ability to build and to accomplish things to their imagination. He says nothing that they have imagined will be restrained from them. And you know, that is absolutely true today. If you can imagine it, I believe that you can do it. Now, you know, some people are going to challenge that because their imagination is not very well developed. And there's very few people use their imagination in a really positive way. And so because of it, we've got a lot of negative imagination people. But I really believe that this is what the Lord is saying. He confounded their language and drove them apart so that they wouldn't be able to accomplish all of these things. And basically, He just stopped their creativity by scattering them abroad and unable to communicate with one another. But it does show the power of imagination. Even God and God's plans for mankind was challenged by their imagination. And He said, nothing that they have imagined will be restrained unto them. Well, I don't know if you understand that, but that is one powerful truth right there. If God was threatened by man's negative imagination, and I hadn't got time to go into it, but this wasn't a good thing that they were doing. They were collectively pooling their imagination and their resources to be able to build a kingdom that would make it to where man wasn't dependent upon God, to where they could go beyond God and they were self-sufficient and self-sustaining. And this wasn't a positive imagination. It was a good thing that God did here to destroy their imaginations in this situation. But if our imagination can challenge God, then that shows how powerful our imagination is. Our imagination is a powerful, powerful force. And yet, the average person today has been taught basically to discount imagination and not to do this, that this is child stuff, this is fantasy, this is more of a delusion, it's make-believe, it has no basis in reality. But imagination is a very positive, constructive thing. As a matter of fact, let me go down and I'm using some of the notes that I've made on my computer here, but the Hebrew word that was translated imagination a number of times in the Old Testament is the Hebrew word Y-E-T-S-E-R, yester. And it was translated imagination in Genesis chapter 6, verse 5. This is where the Lord came down and saw that the imagination of the thoughts of man's heart was only evil continually. And this is what occasioned him bringing the flood upon the earth and destroying them. In Genesis chapter 8, verse 21, he referred to that same thing. Deuteronomy 31, 21, 1 Chronicles 29, 18. It was translated imagination in all of those instances. But it was also translated mind in Isaiah chapter 26 and verse 3. That scripture says, "The Lord shall keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed upon him because he trusteth in him." And the word mind there is this same Hebrew word yester that was translated imagination. So I believe it's accurate to say that when it says that you have to keep your mind stayed upon the Lord, this isn't just talking about individual thoughts, disconnected thoughts. This is talking about in the New Testament. You know, I hadn't got time to do a huge in-depth study on all of this, so I'll just say this briefly, and hopefully if you're interested, you can go check it out. But in the New Testament, the words that are translated like in Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 18, where it talks about having their understanding darkened, that's the Greek word dianoia, and it means deep thought. Not just thought, but deep thought. That's what it's talking about, understanding. There is a thinking level that is just surface, and you don't really grab hold of the truths. It doesn't penetrate. It doesn't possess you. You don't possess those thoughts. It's just a surface thought. But then when you understand something, that is deep thought. And that same word, dianoia, that was translated understanding in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 18, over in Luke chapter 1, it was translated imagination. And so again, the word imagination is talking about your thought process. This is why it was translated mind in Isaiah chapter 26, 3. The Lord will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed upon him. But it's not just talking about your surface thoughts. It's talking about this deep thought or when you get your imagination involved. Now that is a great truth right there. And this is why that the Word of God doesn't penetrate a lot of people, because they just listen to it on a surface level. They don't ever meditate on it until the point that it gets their imagination fueled and fired up and seeing things. Like I remember just when I was first getting turned on to the Lord, and I remember one day reading over in 1 Samuel chapter 17 about David killing Goliath. Now probably every one of you have read that story or you've heard about it sometime or another. Most people have some concept, some information about that. But I remember right after I got really turned on to the Lord, I read this and I just, you know, read the information, but then I put the Bible down and I got to picturing this and imagining what would that really be like. And I remember as a kid going out and on a tree. You know, I read some commentaries, and most commentaries believe that Goliath was over 9 foot tall, about 9 foot six or something, that David was probably 5 foot or less. And so I marked up on a tree where 9 foot six was. I bent down to 5 foot so that I could get a relative idea of how big Goliath was. You know what I was doing? I was using my imagination to make the word come alive. And I sat down and I read the information, but then I pictured it. I remember when I went to Israel on a tour, we drove through the Valley of Elah where David fought Goliath. And there's a road that goes through that valley, and it's still basically uninhabited. It's about 3 or 4 miles from one side of that valley to the other valley. And in the middle, there's this little stream that runs through. It was a dry stream at the time that I was there. They stopped the tour bus right there, and they said, "Does anybody want to get out?" It was a hot day. Most people wanted to stay on the tour bus in the air conditioning. Man, I got out, and I walked down to where that little stream was, and I picked me up 5 smooth stones, just like David did. And I stood there, and I looked around and imagined what it was like to have all of those Philistines on one side, the Israelites on the other side, to see Goliath standing there. I used my imagination, and I tell you, it made that story just come alive for me. See, this is why people, when they go to the Holy Land on a tour, this is why they'll come back and say, "Man, it just made the Bible come alive," and they're so excited about it, and they can't understand. I actually had a tour group that I led, and there were some ladies that thought that there was just a greater anointing in Israel than there was anywhere else. And they'd go into these places, Herod's Judgment Hall, where Jesus was beaten. And they would just say, "Oh, can you feel the anointing?" One of them passed out. Anyway, I hadn't got time to go into that, but they got very religious on us. I had to wind up rebuking people and tell them that, look, God isn't here more than He's someplace else. You know what the difference is? You know what makes the Word seem so real and these things that you've read about become all of a sudden so real and people think that it's just there's a special anointing or something? Know what it is? It fuels your imagination. You can now see something that you've heard about and you've read about, but you really couldn't form a good picture of it. But when you get there and you see it, all of a sudden, things become crystal clear. The vision, the image becomes clear. It's your imagination, your understanding begins to be enlightened. You begin to understand and see things better because now you can picture it better than you could before. You don't have to physically go somewhere to have that happen. A lot of people, it happens to them when they physically go to the land of Israel because they don't use their imagination. Their imagination is underdeveloped. But you can do the same thing right here wherever you are. You can take the Word of God and let the Holy Spirit start revealing things to you to where you see it. You know, I've used this illustration before, but I have taken the Word of God and I have studied the Scriptures about the crucifixion of Jesus, and I have meditated on the suffering and the pain that He went through. And in my imagination, I have seen Jesus crucified. Paul said this in Galatians chapter 3 when he was rebuking the Galatians. He said, "Oh, foolish Galatians, before whose eyes Jesus Christ has been evidently set forth, crucified among you." It says that Christ was crucified before you, evidently set forth. They didn't physically, with their eyes, see Jesus crucified, but through the account that Paul gave, it was just as if they saw Jesus crucified. And you know what? Through studying the Scriptures, I did this. I have seen Jesus crucified. And when I actually saw that show, The Passion of the Christ, there were some people that were so impacted by that. You know why? Because all of a sudden they saw something that they had read about, but that they hadn't given a lot of thought to. They hadn't allowed the Holy Spirit to make it come alive. Their imagination wasn't fueled. And so because of it, it was vague. It wasn't something that they really understood. And because of it, when they saw this presented and they could see it with their physical eyes, it helped them to form a picture of what it was really like of the crucifixion of Jesus. But with me, it was just the opposite. I had spent so much time meditating on the crucifixion of Jesus that when I saw it portrayed in that movie, it was disappointing to me. Because the movie, all it could do was present the physical suffering. And it even didn't do all of that, because over in Isaiah chapter 52, around verse 13, it says that his face was more marred than any person who had ever been on the face of the earth. And it also says that his form was so marred that he didn't even look human. You know, as bad as the person portraying Jesus in that movie, The Passion of the Christ, looked, and I mean he was brutalized, he still looked human. But according to Scripture account, he didn't even look human. And I believe that the way that that happened was he took our sicknesses and our disease in his own body on the tree. He literally had all of this elephantitis and these warts and these growths and these deformities and all of those things entered into the physical body of Jesus. See, that wasn't portrayed in that movie, The Passion of the Christ. And so as bad as that was, and it got an R rating because it was so brutal, the crucifixion of Jesus was actually much, much worse than that. And see, I had meditated on that until I'd seen this in my imagination. And what I was seeing on the screen was not as graphic and not as real as what I saw on the inside. That's imagination. A Holy Ghost, Spirit-filled, fueled, fired imagination. So that when I saw that, I actually was disappointed, because you can see things so much clearer in your imagination than you can see them with your physical eyes. Your imagination is powerful. It's powerful. But you've got to understand that, and you've got to indulge it and actually develop it. It's just like faith. Faith has to be developed. It has to be strengthened. Your imagination has to be strengthened. And your imagination is not just automatically positive. As a matter of fact, the very verses that I'm using to start this teaching on imagination from Romans chapter 1, verse 21, it says that if you don't glorify God, then you won't be thankful. The third step is your imagination becomes vain. That doesn't mean that it quits working. It means that it starts working against you. Your imagination works all of the time, but if you don't develop it, you will see negative things. You will imagine worst-case scenarios. You will see yourself failing. You'll see yourself dying. You'll see your business failing. You'll see your marriage failing. You'll see your children not serving God. Your imagination will just naturally work against you, but it is a powerful force. And if you don't force it to be creative, if you don't take the Word of God and intentionally begin to start seeing the good things that God has promised you come to pass, I can guarantee you your imagination will work, but it will work against you to see all of these negative things come to pass. I've got a lot more to share about this, but I'm out of time today. We'll have to continue it tomorrow. So I encourage you to listen in then, and also listen as our announcer gives you this information, and call or write and get this teaching on hope and imagination.
Andrew's complete teaching titled, How to Fulfill God's Will, was recorded live at a recent Gospel Truth seminar. It's available on either CD or DVD for £16. This series is also available on DVD as seen on our daily TV program. You can receive it for £16 when you write or call. Or you can get today's teaching as part of the God's Will package, which includes three albums: How to Find God's Will, How to Follow God's Will, and How to Fulfill God's Will. As a bonus, the package includes the Destiny Stories DVD, highlighting four stories of people whose lives were transformed as they pursued God's will for their lives. The entire package has a catalog value of £48, but Andrew considers this teaching so important, he'd like to get it to as many people as possible. Therefore, he's offering it to you for a gift of just £40 or more. Remember to specify the CD or DVD package when you order. The fifth audio teaching in today's series is available for £3 when you write or call. But if you're simply unable to afford it, Andrew and his partners will provide this fifth CD titled Hope and Imagination, free of charge. We'd like to remind you that we're offering Andrew's latest book titled God Wants You Well for £8.50. Contact us today to get your copy. You can use your credit card to order resources by telephone. Our helpline number is 01922-473-300. When calling from outside the UK, you must dial your international calling code, then 44-1922-473-300. Helpline hours are from 7 a.m. to 4 p.m. Greenwich Mean Time. Or you can visit our website where you can order ministry materials 24 hours a day, 7 days a week at awme.net. To write us, use the address on your screen. We hope to hear from you today. We'd like to point out Andrew's upcoming speaking schedule. Mark your calendars to come meet Andrew at one of these events and let the Word of God transform your life. He'll be in Colorado Springs for the Andrew Wommack Ministers Conference October 4th through the 8th and in Buxton, Derbyshire in England for the Andrew Wommack Ministries of Europe Ministers Conference October 18th through the 20th. For more details on Andrew's next meeting in your area, call our helpline or visit our website at awme.net.
I'd like to invite all of the full-time ministers to join me on October the 18th through the 20th for our 2010 Ministers Conference in the UK. We're coming back to Buxton, Derbyshire, England, and I tell you, I always enjoy this. Bob Yandian is going to be with me. Charlie and Jill LeBlanc will be doing praise and worship. And we just always have a powerful time. I mean, this last year we saw some miraculous things happen. People miraculously healed, and the ministers just encouraged by the Word of God. It's always a special time of encouragement. It's a great location, so make plans to join me October the 18th through the 20th at Buxton in Derbyshire, England for our 2010 Ministers Conference.
For 8 years, Richard Anthony Waller struggled with debilitating and life-threatening health issues.
I was regularly walking on crutches. I was taking a lot of painkillers, and I was in a pretty bad way. And Charlie prayed his prayer, and I walked away, and I still felt the pain, but I knew and I believed that I was healed.
Today, he's totally and completely healed.
I'm healed. That's it. I'm healed. Everything. I'm healed. Everything. Everything is healed.
Check out his story today. Log on to awmi.net. Look to the left and click on Ministry News. Discover what's happening at Andrew Wommack Ministries.
You do not have to motivate God to heal. God wants to heal more than you want to be healed.
The almost too good to be true news you can use. www.awmi.net.